Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful still. This is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 32 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. This week, I had the distinct honor of interviewing a living legend in the Atlanta startup and tech community, Jacqui Chu. Jacqui is a TEDx licensee, which are the independently organized TED conferences, and heads TEDx Peachtree, as well as the Startup Catalyst at ATDC, Georgia Startup Incubator. As the CEO of iFusion, a go-to-market consultancy that helps high-growth potential technology companies accelerate growth, Jacqui is a seasoned digital strategist with hands-on experience in lean marketing and product launches. Well-versed in SaaS, media, and Internet of Things business models, and has a successful track record of developing 2D and 3D marketing plans to support product and company launches, brand identity development, community building through social channels, and B2B lead nurturing programs. So if you haven't noticed already, credentials are really, really thick, and she could not be any nicer. So without further ado, let's hop into our interview with Atlanta tech startup legend, Jacqui Chu. Jacqui, thanks so much for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
No problem. So to say that you are heavy in the Atlanta startup space would be an understatement bordering on criminally remiss, and you also help organize TEDx for Peachtree. But nobody starts out like that. Nobody starts at the top of the mountain. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug, and how did you find yourself into the startup space and all things digital marketing?
Sure. To tell you that story, I have to start in 1997 when I first arrived in Atlanta from Hawaii, and it was a huge career change and a life change for me, and Atlanta was awesome. It seemed like a really good idea because it was the year after the Olympics. So coming here and making a concerted decision to have a career change was a big step. And finding my first role here was the other big step, with absolutely no references or any connections or contacts in this town. And I would say that, you know, the ability to just be tenacious and push on and land on your feet is probably something that you're going to hear throughout this whole story. So 1997, I joined a large global communications firm. At the time, this was the dinosaur ages of the internet, as you well know, where we still had external modems and they still made noises that I'm not going to try and complete. So my background at the time was in consumer packaged goods and lifestyle marketing. And I joined the consumer's practice of a very large firm, like I said. But I was pulled into the technology practice, serving technology clients, because a colleague couldn't quite lead the team. And so I was pulled in to lead the team because of my specific expertise. And it was to launch one of the very first parental web filtering products, like a net nanny type product that was actually installed. And this will sound very interesting and funny to many of you who haven't seen a regular PC with a tower and a floppy disk slot. But this software was actually installed into your computer using a 3.5-inch floppy disk. So that was way back in 1998 or so. And then based on the success of that particular campaign, that launch, I was brought in to lead other teams to launch many, many, many other technology products. So that was how I got started.
Awesome. So when was the honeymoon over? When did you become disenchanted? Not necessarily disillusioned, but switching careers is kind of like marriage, right? When you first start, everything's new and different. then you find out that this person snores like a dying moose and has all these other quirks. So when did things get real for you in the startup space and that shiny veneer kind of came off a little?
So actually, I didn't really get a taste of being a part of a startup because back up until 2000, early 2000. So I joined SilverPop back in early 2000 before they were known as SilverPop, and I was their first internal marketing hire. And you know, at the time, it was right before the stock market crashed in 2000. I believe it was February of 2000. And my time at SilverPop was really marked by the crash as well as 9/11, which is sort of unfortunate. So I would say that it was quite a wake-up call to know that the promotional aspects of marketing is important, but actually to understand the other functions within an organization, within a company, was even more important. So I resolved from that learning, that experience, that actually taking the time to understand how business works and how customers think and looking at products from a customer's point of view was really, really important. And it actually has stood me well in my career to date.
Absolutely. And that must have been quite the roller coaster ride, especially 9/11, because I know that hit businesses especially hard. So if you had a time machine, you can go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. Yes, I watched Doctor Who. What are the top three things that you would tell your younger self to help prepare for your career?
Number one, I would say to myself, not that I would listen, I would say to my younger self to not worry so much about getting to the end and to focus on the here and the now. Two, to spend more time reflecting on yourself and your needs and your wants and your vision for what you want to be, and then work backwards and plot your course on a personal level and a career level accordingly. And three, it really is in marketing, it is not about the push. It is about the customers and finding that happy medium, that alignment between the customer wants and needs and a company's value proposition.
That is some very sage advice I wish I had myself a few years back. So now I'm going to ask you to look into the future, because one of the areas of digital marketing that I focus on is mobile / connected devices / Internet of Things. And sort of the standard example that everybody gives is the smart refrigerator that knows when you're out of milk and automatically adds it to your shopping list and is then delivered via Amazon drone. And in that scenario, it's what they call a closed loop environment, because you never have to leave the house. It's kind of like the Jetsons. Everything is so animated. And so there's been some talk in the marketing space as to what marketing is going to look like and if we would all still have jobs in a future like that. So I know that that's, you know, several decades away, but what do you see the future of marketing and our roles as marketers being once we reach that future of the Jetsons?
So that's a really good question, the future of marketing and the future of marketers. I happen to think that with that particular question, the assumption is that marketing is only about promotion. Marketing is all about push and putting a product in its most optimal way in front of the supposed customer. Well, my definition of marketing is broader. For me, there are the classical four P's of marketing. And the first, of course, is product. And does the product meet a customer's needs or the intended customer's needs? So in startup marketing, we are maniacal about ensuring that entrepreneurs look for a product market fit. And we also, in order for it to be a successful business versus a product, we are maniacal about asking our entrepreneurs to make sure that finding product market fit, ensuring that the market wants to pay for the product and there's enough of a market to pay for the product to sustain the business. Okay, so that's a product piece. The second P is placement, which is distribution or channels, the way in which a product is delivered to the end customer. And the third is pricing. So pricing it in a way that is appropriate for the target market. So there are four P's. The fourth one is promotion. So I truly believe that in the future, marketers are going to have to be more strategic about, they would take on more strategic activities, and the more tactical activities will be performed, could possibly be performed by AI or an agent. So chatbots are the early version of that future. So chatbots are sort of taking over from the very basic FAQs or customer service type reps, answering very basic questions. And so that's kind of where I see things. I think humans will always be viable and relevant. We are just going to be asked to be more strategic and to perform the contextual activities to be able to interpret the data that is produced by all of these, all this automation and all these smart objects, if you would, and interpret all that data to come up with insights and for which actions can be made.
Absolutely. I'm not a technophobe. I'm not afraid that, you know, Google, Skynet and the singularity. I think that technology frees up humans to do what we're best at. And so if you, Gary V, Brian Solis, or insert whichever thought leader, if you happen to be at a different conference, Jay Bear, whoever, you're all sitting at a bar after the conference having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the current digital marketing landscape, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
I would say that I would love to pick their brains on what they thought their roles would be, because these are clearly well-respected thought leaders in the industry and among digital marketers worldwide. I would be curious to see how they saw their role shifting. And what their thoughts were of all the noise and all the tools, all the marketing technology tools and ad tech tools that are available, as well as the tools that are being built today. Where do they see that going?
Absolutely. So we're going to take a short break. And then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Jacqui Chu. So stick with me. We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave and now she's a multimillionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left him bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it, hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now, I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, Being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttimmy.com to book me, and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon. And we're back. So, Jacqui, myself and my co-author, we wrote a book last year called Beyond Buzzwords. And by far, the buzzword of 2016 was influencer marketing. Like, not even close. Influencer marketing was all over the place. Jay Baer of Convince and Convert even launched a podcast called Influence Pros. And those in the space warned that it was only a matter of time before we had our first influencer marketing train wreck. And I mean, not just a regular train wreck, but a spectacular train wreck, like mushroom clouds, debris going everywhere, which we just got courtesy of one PewDiePie. So for those who are unaware, PewDiePie is like the first rags to riches YouTube success story. He was the first YouTube channel with a billion, that's a billion with a B, views, and he makes roughly about $4 million a year from his channel, and he previously had relationships with Maker and Disney, among few others. But the reason I say previously is because PewDiePie decided to take shots at the website Fiverr.com and the ridiculous things that you can get people to do for as little as $5. However, the way in which he chose to go about this was by paying people to do anti-Semitic things. And of course, this led to this huge kerfuffle, and Disney and a few others severed ties with him. And so my question to you is two parts. How do you see this fiasco affecting influencer marketing as a whole? Because Disney actually received some blowback from abandoning PewDiePie. And Chris Brogan on the Marketing Companion podcast brought up a very interesting point that the way that digital natives use language is fundamentally different from the way that you and I might use language. And part two of the question is, in this whole clickbaity internet that we find ourselves in, the trend has been toward ever more salacious headline and outrageous things. So do you think that PewDiePie's antics will embolden would-be YouTube superstars to be even more outrageous, or do you think it'll have a cooling effect?
I think it's very dangerous to generalize an entire country or entire world's reaction to this. So let's, I prefer to look at it from a generational point of view. So from, it really depends on the brand and the brand's stakeholders as to whether something like a PewDiePie, an incident like a PewDiePie or an influencer gone the rogue is negative or positive to the brand. So this is actually not the idea of an influencer who is a paid spokesperson of sorts is not new. So think Tiger Woods. I mean, Tiger Woods is a global superstar golfer, but when all of that came down with his wife and such, it was messy. It was terrible for Nike. And, it was very, very public. So the brands always run that risk of leveraging a celebrity or an internet celebrity to amplify their message. They always do. And believe you me, they have a reputation management team or a crisis communication team that is standing ready for those kinds of contingencies. So where do I think this will go in terms of other internet celebrities, other YouTube celebrities, et cetera, where they would go in terms of becoming more and more outrageous because they are encouraged by Disney fans, you know, disapproval of Disney ditching this person? Well, I would say that at some point, should these influencers decide to be more and more outrageous for clicks, at some point, and this will be interesting from a generational, demographical, behavioral change point of view, is watching the Gen Z, or that generation born between 1995 and 2005, who and the first generation born and grown up in an age where there was always an internet, it would be interesting to see how they react, that up and coming generation react to this sort of behavior. I personally think that humans have a certain threshold for noise, and at some point, they're going to be numb to whatever outrageous stunts are being conducted by the influencer, and it will have a negative effect, but it will have a neutral effect. It will negate itself, meaning that, you know, it's so outrageous that people just tune the person out. That's what I think.
Very interesting. And if attention is what you're after, how you support yourself, being tuned out is pretty much the worst thing that can happen. So very astute. Okay. So without getting political, but by all means express yourself, because candor is the whole point of the podcast. What's your take on the whole fake news debate after the 2016 election? And just to back up for those who may not know, in the last 3 months leading up to the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news began to outperform real news on Facebook. And by fake news, I mean these stories were wholesale fabricated, had no factual basis in reality. It was not a simple matter of spinning the facts one direction or another, which all news does. There were no underlying facts to be spun. And immediately afterwards, Mark Zuckerberg sort of played it off and was like, oh, no. It's highly unlikely that Facebook had anything to do with the outcome of the election. And he has since kind of conceded that the whole fake news problem has outstripped Facebook's current ability to govern it. And they're in the process of coming out with AI, which is artificial intelligence, and third-party verifications to try to tackle the whole fake news problem. And this has sparked a really interesting debate in the digital marketing community, because you have some people who are straight First Amendment, who are like, no, Facebook does not have any business trying to be the arbiters of truth. And then you have others who are like, Facebook is a digital property, and as a property owner, you are ultimately responsible for what goes on your property. It's no different than, let's say, you're away on business and some knucklehead teenagers hop your fence so they can go skinny dipping in your pool and one of them drowns. You put up a fence. They were trespassing. It doesn't matter. Happened on your property, you're ultimately responsible. So again, without getting political, as a professional digital marketer, where's your stance on Facebook sort of flexing its muscle and coming down on fake news?
That's an interesting question. So the bad news is there was a study done showing that millennials were more likely to believe in fake news as real, which is disappointing. And the good news is this is a pendulum swinging situation, wherein it's swinging pretty far to one end in terms of what the echo chambers that people choose to live in. So to me, fake news is nothing but an extension of traditional media, traditional broadcast media that is agenda-based. And reporting, they report the facts, but they are also, through the use of certain very subtle language, exhibit a certain bias toward one ideology over the other. So fake news to me is just an extension of what has been going on for years and years, where people, certain groups of people tune in to only a certain group of channels and others only tune in to another group of channels. And neither groups would tune into the channels for which they are not self-identified to be a part of. Having said that, with regards to using technology, so I'll address it in a larger way, using algorithmic technologies and AI to solve a problem that is a human problem is also fraught with its dangers, because algorithms are written by humans who have inherent biases. And let me just explain how that is. If you, for example, were to type in, if you did a Google search for jobs, and Google knows that you are a minority, or in this case, an African-American and such, there is a very high likelihood that you would be given search results of certain types of jobs that are in the service industry, in the administrative type positions, et cetera, et cetera, versus someone else who Google recognizes to be someone who is white, middle class, upper middle class, et cetera, et cetera. It will return a different set of search results. So this might be a little bit stunning to hear, but this was a research project that was done out of, I want to say, a university in North Carolina. I could be wrong, but it was a university here in the South by a professor who did a TED Talk about exactly this topic. And it is a distinctive problem. Algorithmic solutions to a very human problem is highly flawed. And whilst I applaud a company trying to take responsibility for ensuring that accurate information is being shared and disseminated, I believe that the approach to the solution to the problem is inherently fraught with danger in and of itself.
That's very true, because the county escapes me at the moment, but there was a county here in Georgia where the police tried to come up with an algorithm that could predict repeat offenders, recidivism rates is what they call it. And the person programming it said that African Americans were 5 times more likely to be repeat offenders. And the algorithm was only 20% accurate, which means that 80% of the time it was inaccurate because of those, you know, as you mentioned, those human biases that got programmed into the algorithms. It's a slippery slope if ever there was one. So next question, and I'm interested in your response, given your involvement with the startup space. So large corporations are just now starting to really buy into digital marketing. And by that, I mean that at least now in a lot of bigger brands, you have a position or department dedicated to digital marketing, where as early as 5 years ago, you didn't even have that. The ad spend is disproportionately going to Facebook and Google. Like, it's not even close. They're getting like 85, 90 cents of every dollar a digital marketing ad spend. And so the laws of supply and demand dictate that as you have more competition for a limited supply of ad inventory, that the cost per click is going to rise. And we have seen that over the years, that clicks are becoming more expensive. So as the big boys throw those elephant dollars around and get more and more involved into advertising, do you think we'll have a situation where the smaller players kind of get squeezed out and only Coca-Cola and Nike can afford to advertise on Google and Facebook? Or do you think that, true to its nature, when that threshold is reached, that the something new will come along to disrupt it?
My short answer is no, because smart marketers who are focused on the customer psychographic, and the customer online behavior will find creative ways to reach that customer and to engage with that customer across multiple channels. So I am not a digital marketing purist in that I don't believe that all engagement and all interactions between a brand prior to purchase and their audience or their customer is going to happen online. I don't believe that for one moment. I actually believe that as more and more big brands push online, that even the millennials at some point in the buyer journey are going to want to have, in the right context, an actual human interaction, which is almost heresy for a digital marketer type person to say, right? But I believe that when you push hard and so hard on something, on a certain channel, that it gets to be so noisy and will get eventually tuned out, such that the smart marketer, so the startups who don't have the resources to spend on paid media, will find other more interesting, more relevant, more engaging, more resonant ways to reach their audience. So, I mean, there's that famous story of Tinder. So Tinder, at launch, hosted parties at college campuses as a way to propagate the download of their app. So that was a form of paid media, if you want, you know, loosely speaking. But what they did was the requirement to to enter the party was for the attendee to show that they had downloaded the app and put a profile together. So, I mean, it was a great way to encourage usage and associate the download and the setup of profile with a fun, positive experience.
Absolutely. So last question, and I'll let you get back to your day. And I do appreciate your time, but I am going to take just a couple moments to set it up because I want you to understand why I'm asking it the way that I'm asking it. It's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked in his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast, because in my professional opinion, there's a gap in the professional digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean someone who works in-house at a brand or on the agency side. I am not referring to digital entrepreneurship, somebody like a Pat Flynn or John Lee Dumas, even though you can absolutely make the case that they're pros because they operate at such a high level. It's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs. So in terms of professionalizing yourself, there's sort of three tracks that people go on. The first is that you can meander the wilds of Google. And while, yes, there is a lot of good information out there, a lot of which is for free, contrary to popular belief, rooting it out does take a little bit of skill. You may land on Convince and Convert. You may end up doing Amway. Like, who knows where that rabbit hole goes, right? The second path is that you can do what I did, is go back for a degree in digital marketing. The cons there is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 to get my undergraduate. Plus, it's time consuming because even though my degree program was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete. And in the digital land space, 30 months is several lifetimes. But by far, the most prevalent way that people educate themselves and disseminate best-in-class practices is through conferences and seminars. The cons there is that even though in aggregate it's a lot less expensive than getting a degree, you have to have that money up front. So take your better conferences like a South by Southwest or a social media marketing world, something like that. You're looking at $500 to $1,500 just to get your foot in the door. That doesn't include your flight, your hotel, Uber, eating out for however many days. Once you add all that back in, you're easily looking at $3,000 to $5,000 out of pocket on a single conference. So I'm trying to crowdsource, if you will, a way of professionalizing oneself that does not include rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or having to take a loan out against your life insurance policy so that you can afford a conference. So now that I just rambled on for however long, I'll ask the actual question, which is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the skills and experience you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke, Jacqui. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
Okay, well, that's easy. So I'm going to ask you one question for that. Why do I need to talk to industry thought leaders?
Oh, that's a very good question. No one's ever asked that. Just to build relationships, get your name out there.
Oh, okay. So I'm looking at them as a conduit to referrals. Is that the deal?
More or less, correct.
Okay. Well, first of all, I would never do that. I would never do that because it is not the entrepreneur's way. Second of all, so having decided that that's not what I'm going to do, so I'm going to break the rules, which is also an entrepreneur's way, is I will take a look at what I have available that is relevant and appealing and is unique enough that this new world that I find myself in, people in there would actually pay for. And then I would figure out what that, once I figured out what that is, then I would have figured out, well, okay, I'm going to go interview these people and try and understand in the realm of marketing, because you've told me that my parameter is I'm a marketer and I have all the skills in that. I'm going to ask them about their concerns, perceptions, and challenges with regard to growth of their business, growing their business, launching their business, keeping customers who are their customers, onboarding, which would be the adoption process and the success of that after a customer has bought whatever the company is providing. I would do the interviews in order to better understand the customer challenges in this area of customer growth and customer retention, and where my unique skill sets intersect. And then because I've talked to probably 10, 50 people probably in less than 30 days, because I can most likely do about 10 interviews a day, and the interview's about 20 minutes, 30 minutes a piece, I would have, at the end of each interview, have asked them if I could update them on my little project when I'm done with it, with the results. And most of them, I would say 80% of them would probably say yes, because I have a belief that people are inherently good and want to be helpful. Then I would then, once I just figured out what the unique selling proposition that I have to offer to them, I would then package it, and then I would go to them and tell them that I'm offering this. And because they have taken the time to talk to me, they have a vested interest in and curiosity in seeing what I've come up. And there's a really good chance, because I'm a good listener, that they would actually want to try what I have to sell.
I love it. I absolutely love it. I hope you guys were taking notes, because you just got a master's class. Jacqui, this has been tremendous. Please take a moment. Tell us where to find you online. Tell us what you got going on at the Startup Incubator. Tell us about TEDx Peachtree. Where can we get some more of you?
You can find me at atdc.org. I'm on the team page, and I do office hours once a month at Flatiron City in downtown Atlanta. Those are absolutely for free, and they're 30 minutes a session. They do book out, so I encourage you to go there quick and book them. And also with TEDx Peachtree, please go to TEDxPeachtree.com. We have a whole series of events coming up. There's TED Cinema, April 24th. And we also have our official 2017 season kickoff, Cuatro de Mayo. You can't possibly forget that, Cuatro de Mayo. So to get all of this, go to Facebook and follow us there, or better yet, go to TEDxPeachtree.com, TEDxPeachtree.com, and sign up for email updates.
And there you have it, folks. Jacqui, thank you so much. If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.